Good evening and happy Sabbath, everyone. Welcome to our Vesper program. May that all of us is in good health and all of us are ready to worship our Lord Jesus.
Hymn number 508 in the ISDA hymnal.
Jesus, I can safely go. Anywhere He leads me in this world below. Anywhere without Him, dearest joys would fail. Anywhere with Jesus, I am not afraid. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus, anywhere with Jesus, I am not alone. Other friends may fail me, He is still my own. Though His hands may lead me over dreary ways, anywhere with Jesus, He's a house of praise. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Anywhere with Jesus I can go to sleep. When the gloomy shadows round about me creep, knowing I shall wake and never more to roam. Anywhere with Jesus will be home sweet home. Anywhere, anywhere, fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go.
For our opening prayer, let us bow our head. Heavenly Father, we gather in your presence tonight with open hearts and minds and ready to worship and praise your holy name. We ask that you bless this time of worship so that we may be uplifted and inspired by your presence. Fill us with your love and grace, and help us to honor you in all that we do. May that this worship will be pleasing to you, O Lord, and will be transformed by the power of your Spirit. We thank you, O Lord, and we offer this prayer in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Seek this Jesus. Presenting today for today's Vesper service is come as you are, but do not stay as you are. When we come to God, we are to come as we are. We are urged, encouraged to come as we are, for it is the Lord who does the transformation. And thus, the emphasis on my topic is not to stay as we are. This emphasis is showcased in biblical characters. I will start off with Nebuchadnezzar, who was a pagan king of Babylon, but he was then transformed into a witness. How? By the power of God in the lives of the three Hebrew boys and in Daniel. Not only was he then a witness, but he also became a testifier of the body of Christ. And this was captured in Daniel 4:37, where he declares, "Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and exalt and glorify the King of heaven, because everything he does is right and all his ways are just." Transformation in the Bible, we also see it with biblical names. We have from Abraham to Abraham, from Jacob to Israel, from Simon to Peter, from Saul to Paul. And the transformation of name is not only synonymous with the Bible characters, but also with us as believers. We're now referred to as the children of God. We are transformed. We are transformed from the, transferred to be exact, from the kingdom of darkness into the power of Jesus Christ, into light. We are referred to as children of light. You know, we refer to ourselves as Christians. We refer to ourselves as born again believers. So transformation is even with names, as we see in the Bible. But not only that, even scripture emphasizes transformation. We see in Romans 12:2, where it says, "Be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove that which is the will of good, perfect, good, and acceptable." In 2 Corinthians 4:16, it says that our inner man is being renewed day by day. So we see there's transformation and there's renewal in being in Christ Jesus. But it doesn't stop there. Excuse me. Because as we move forward, we have the emphasis and we understand as believers that if we are pardoned, it is through his blood. If we are justified, it is through his righteousness. If we are sanctified by the Holy Spirit, in whom is the gift he gave to us, it is still Christ Jesus. That if we are kept from falling, it is because we are preserved in Christ Jesus. And that at last and finally, if we are perfect, it is because we are complete in Jesus Christ. And so now in this word of today, I will be emphasizing renewal and transformation that is only evident, that is only found in Jesus Christ. And with that, I would like to take us to the Bible for us to read three Bible verses that I will be emphasizing for now, which is, we'll be starting with 1 Peter 2:2. And this reads, as newborn babes desire the pure milk of the word that you may grow. In 1 Corinthians 3, I will be reading from 1 until 3, that says, and I, brethren, could not speak to you as to spiritual people, but as to carnals, as to babes in Christ. In verse 2 of the 1 Corinthians 3, it says, I fed you with milk and not with solid food. For until now, you were not able to receive it. And even now you are still not able, for you are still carnal. In Hebrews, which is the last Bible verse that we will be reading, from Hebrews 5:12 says, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principle of the oracles of God. And you have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. And with this, now I will bring this analogy or the idea of babies. When we look at babies in their early stages, right, they drink an ounce of milk here and there, and this is distributed in the course of the day. So maybe they'll drink in the morning, in the afternoon, and before they sleep. But we understand that that milk sustains them. That milk is sufficient for their life stage that they're in. But as they grow, as they progress, they need more milk. They eventually need more food that is now solid food, and in that they're healthy and they're whole. And in the same way, we as Christians are in need of spiritual food. We are in need of spiritual food. And Peter emphasizes, as newborn babes desire the pure milk. But it doesn't stop there. He's urging us, why are we to desire the pure milk? It's so that we may grow, so that there's transformation, there's renewal. So once again, we as Christians, in the beginning of our walk, we are urged as newborn babes to desire the pure milk. And this, for example, in our time, in our beginning time with the Lord, this will look like us, you know, reading a paragraph of scripture a day, right? We have 15 minutes of prayer. And that was sufficient at that time, because again, we're just getting into it. You know, we're trying to incorporate God into our routine. And that was well and good in that time, for you are still a babe. You are still a newborn babe. But as maturing believer, for now you have grown, you have progressed, like how babies, right, transition from a toddler to a teenager to an adult. So we maturing believer, and as maturing believers, we also have to increase our intake. We need to advance. We need to acquire not milk anymore. But for us to grow, we need the baby food. We need sustenance of the of us being maturing believer. We need sustenance of that time. And it's not milk then. Then now we will need food. We will need solid food. For in Hebrews, once again, the emphasis was that solid food belongs to those who are of full age. But those who take only milk, they are described as unskilled in the word of righteousness, for they are only babes. And so with that, when we look at this idea of having the spiritual food, when our intake is not appropriate for the stage that we're in as maturing believer, it affects us. It is dangerous. And the dangers come because this leaves room for the evil one. We have to understand, it's described that the enemy is like a roaring lion waiting to devour. And so when we are not having the sustenance that is needed in that time, as maturing believers, we're susceptible. We're susceptible, and this leaves room. We're told not to give the enemy a foothold. But if our intake does not match the stage that we're in as maturing believer, we leave room for the evil one. For the enemy knows that we need time in prayer. We need more time in prayer, not only time, but now we have to have in-depth prayer. Now we have to have fervent prayer. Now we have to more, to have more effectual prayer. For James recalls and says that the prayers of the righteous one, the effectual and fervent prayers of a righteous one avail much. And so when we also look at it, we need to be in Christ. We need to be in his word, because now we have more things to steward. Now we have new and greater responsibilities, because now we are witnesses. Now we are testifiers of the body of Christ. And so therefore, this is one of the dangers where we leave room for the evil one. But the other danger is because it affects our effectiveness. It affects our progress and it affects our fruitfulness. And when we're describing the fruitfulness, I would like for us to go to Matthew 13. We have the story, or we have more of the parable of the sower. And in this parable, I'd like for all of us to agree to agree that we are the seeds that are falling on the good soil, that we are in the good soil and that we are growing. And so in this parable, there's the emphasis of the growth. You grow because you are one who hears and understands the word, right? But the distinction, there's a distinction here. And the distinctions that I would like for us to emphasize and to look into is the yield, right? Because it's says, right, this is the one who produces a crop yielding 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. And so my emphasis here that I would like to emphasize is that the yield, you're told that some into 30 yields, 60 yields, and 100 yield. And this yield now is dependent on the nutrients. For let's say a new babe, when we were getting in our relationship with Christ, we would probably be producing 30 yield. But now as maturing believer, we need to challenge ourselves that we are for sure producing 60 yield, for sure producing 100 yield, and even beyond that. For that is the calling, that is the transformation that is required of us, that we are daily being renewed, daily being transformed. And this is dependent on the intake of the food that we are having as maturing believers. And so once again, we have discussed that the dangers will be the effectiveness, the dangers will be the progress, the dangers will be the fruitfulness, and the other danger is that we will leave room for the evil one. Once again, we're not to give a foothold to the enemy. And so with that, when we're discussing of the devotion, we are to be renewed, right? Day by day, as is described in the previous verse that we had covered. And so now I'll bring for us to read Hosea 14:5, that says, in which God is declaring, I will be like the dew to Israel. And so we have to understand that dew is a source of freshness. It is nature's provision for renewing the face of the earth. It falls at night, and without it, vegetation will die. So just as nature is bathed in the dew, the Lord renews his people as well, right? He renews us in our word of God. Right, we can recognize, so I have this example, we can recognize the foolishness or the folly of a laborer attempting to work all day without eating, that they're trying to work, but we know that they're going to probably get tired at one point, and that the sustenance that they thought they had is actually not sufficient for the workload that they're having. And in the same way, are we though able, right, to recognize, are we able to recognize as servants of God, as living sacrifices unto the Lord, right, us ministering without eating heavenly manna, without eating heavenly food, which is the word of God? Are we able to recognize that folly or that foolishness of going about our day without having the sustenance, or going about our life depending on the milk that we had as beginners, as believers, as fresh believers of faith? Are we able to see how that doesn't match up? That now we're in a new season. Now we're referring to ourselves as maturing believers, but we're still taking milk. We're still sitting and reading only a paragraph a day, only praying for 15 minutes. But now we have to understand, as maturing believer, it is literally that we need to have greater intake of food. We have to have greater intake of spiritual food, greater intake of the word. That now we need to be able to have, let's say, all the parables in our fingertips, that we're able to minister not only to other people, but to ourselves. And so with that, we have to understand that our nutrition our devotion need and has to carry the weight of the seasons that we are in, especially in the time that we are in. And therefore, I'm urging that every day we need to ensure that we are being renewed by the Holy Spirit. We are asking for the renewal. And not only that, as we move forward, every day also we need to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And this is seen in Matthew 6:33. And so therefore, in the season and the time that we are now in, I challenge you, that the challenge in which I present to you is, are we being renewed daily? The question comes, are you walking circumspectly as wise and not fools? Are you storing the extra oil as the wise virgins did? Are you working now when it's still daytime? For our Lord says that it comes night where no man can work. Absolutely no man can work. So are we working during this daytime where we can still have time to be able to consecrate ourselves and have our alone time with the Lord, to have solitude with God our Father? We saw this example, the prime example in which Christ set, right? He would get up every morning and pray. He would get up and consecrate himself from the disciple, go into the mountains to pray, because he knew he needed the renewal of the Spirit. He knew he needed his time in the Lord, because there was not only much responsibility on him, much, I believed, more to steward in his life, but accordance to the tasks he performed or the miracles, he knew how much more he needed the Lord. So as Jesus relied on the Holy Spirit to renew him, to give him power, how much more are we relying on the Holy Spirit, right? And this can be found in God's word. We can read the Lord's word and every day be renewed, every day seek transformation, because there is a beauty in transformation, especially in Christ Jesus. Because we have to understand, the more we grow in Christ Jesus, the more he becomes lovelier, the more he becomes dearer, the more he becomes blessed. And this is not because he improves in himself. No, Jesus is perfect. He is already perfect. But what happens is that we are transformed in our characters. We are transformed in our knowledge of Christ Jesus. And therefore now we are able to appreciate him more thoroughly. We're able to appreciate his unparalleled majesty and excellence. And so once again, the challenge is that this year, this month of February, if you're to compare in the coming month, let's say of July, ensure that there's transformation, ensure that there is renewal of you. Evaluate yourself and ask God that where you are lacking, we have to know that he is full of, he is abundant, rich in glory, and that he can give that unto us. So let us ask in reverence. Let us ask in humility, because we have to understand, when we read in Daniel, it said that Daniel had sought in his heart to understand. He humbled himself before the Lord, and therefore what he asked for, he received. For it says, ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door will be opened unto you. Our Lord loves to give. He's a great giver. All good gifts comes from him. So let us take time in our day today and reflect upon this word, and let us apply ourselves. Let us seek to be transformed, to be renewed. Let us settle for nothing until Christ Jesus is the only one who is magnified. Let us be nothing so that Christ Jesus is everything in our lives. Be blessed.